Good day, everyone. We are the group 2, and in this presentation, we will discuss the building envelope system and assemblies. The building envelope is the physical barrier between the exterior and interior environments enclosing a structure. It is the enclosure, barrier, and separator of the outdoor environment and the desired indoor environment. It is also the protector from the undesired outdoor threats of danger. As shown in the figure, the building envelope is composed of roof, walls, windows, door, and foundation. It protects the interior space from the effects of the exterior environment like precipitation, wind, temperature, humidity, and ultraviolet radiation. The interior environment is comprised of the occupants, furnishing, building materials, lighting, machinery, equipment, and the HVAC system, or heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. Improving the building envelope of houses is one of the best ways to get better energy efficiency. Energy-efficient building design involves constructing or upgrading buildings that helps to reduce energy loss, such as decreasing the loss of heat through the envelope. A building envelope serves many functions. These functions can be divided into three categories: support, control, and finish. The support function of the building is to ensure strength and rigidity, providing structural support against internal and external loads and forces, while its control function is to control the exchange of water, air, condensation, and heat between the interior and the exterior of the building. And finally, its finish function. This is for the aesthetic purposes, to make the building look active while it's still performing support and control functions. The building envelope also includes the below-grade basement walls, foundation, and floor slab, so that the envelope includes everything that separates the interior of the building from the outdoor environment. The connection of all the non-structural elements to the building structure is also included. Finally, it is recognized that the exterior envelope plays a major role in determining the aesthetic quality of the building exterior, in its form, color, texture, and cultural association. The following are considered as part of the building envelope: below-grade construction, exterior roles, both structural, providing support for the building, and non-structural, supported by the building structure. Fenestration, both windows and metal or glass curtain walls. Roofs, both low and steep slope. And lastly, atria. The design of the envelope is very complex, and many factors have to be evaluated and balanced to ensure the desired levels of thermal, acoustic, and visual comfort, together with safety, accessibility, and aesthetic excellence. The figure illustrates the envelope system of a typical building. A portion of the envelope showing some of the other system that integrated with the envelope. Fundamentals of performance. Performance refers to the desired level or standard to which the system must be designed for a given requirements. The envelope has to respond both to natural forces and human values. The natural forces include rain, snow, wind, and sun. Human concerns include safety, security, and task success. The envelope provides protection by enclosure and by balancing internal and external environmental forces. The envelope, in terms of performance and function, experiences a variety of loads, including but not limited to structural loads, both static and dynamic, and air, heat, and moisture loads. The enclosure must then support structural loads and control environmental loads, which include both long-term and short-term loads. In addition, the envelope, primarily the wall, has several aesthetic attributes that can be summarized as finishes. Thus, the systems and assemblies of the envelope are one of the four main building systems, both in terms of their physical existence and in their contribution to overall building performance. The following are the functional requirements of a building envelope. Number one is structural. If the wall is not part of the main building structure, then it must support its own weight and transfer lateral loads to the building frame. Number two, it must resist water penetration. Number three, air. Resist excessive air infiltration. Number four, condensation. It must resist condensation on interior surfaces under service conditions. Number five, movement. Accommodate differential movement caused by moisture or seasonal or diurnal temperature variations and structural movement. Number six, conservation. It must resist thermal transfer through the radiation, convection, and conduction. Number seven, sound. Attenuate sound transmission. Number eight, fire safety. Provide rated resistance to heat and smoke. Number nine, protect occupants from outside threats. Number 10, maintainability. Allow access to components for maintenance, restoration, and replacement. Constructability. Provide adequate clearances, alignments, and sequencing to allow integration of many components during construction using available components and attainable workmanship. Number 12, durability. Provide functional and aesthetic characteristic for a long time. Number 13, aesthetics. Do all the above functions and still look attractive. Number 14 is economy. Do all the above functions in an inexpensive way.
Aesthetics. Building envelope systems. The design of the envelope is very complex, and many factors have to be evaluated and balanced to ensure the desired levels of thermal, acoustic, and visual comfort, together with safety, accessibility, and aesthetic excellence. The envelope plays a role in almost every building function, either directly or indirectly in its relationship to the other building systems. To have a properly functioning building envelope, the system needs to have three key elements, which are support, control, and finish. Regarding finish, a building envelope provides aesthetic value. Finish functions mean meeting the desired visual aesthetic, both on the inside and outside. It also takes into account both form and function. Commercial, residential, and industrial buildings need to maintain certain levels of curb appeal, and the building's exterior plays a significant role in that. Using appealing exterior building materials and following popular styles provide a high quality finish. The finish function at both the exterior and interior is the aesthetic of the finished surface. The visual, textural, and other aspects the designer wishes to convey with the visible elements of the system. On to aesthetics. Aesthetics has been a powerful influence on the envelope. An architect makes aesthetic decisions in full collaboration with the client, building user, other consultants, and the public. Therefore, it is important for the client and the building user to be well informed about the possibilities of architecture. Here are some fundamental design elements used by architects and designers. First is the archetypical building elements, which are separated into two categories. First is the vertical. Example of this are walls, arch, beam lintel, quoin, column, orders, base, shaft, capital, windows, and doors. Second is horizontal. Example of this are plinth, floor, and roofs. The second fundamental design element is style. Style is a distinctive manner of expressionism or fashion at a specific time in history. In architecture, historical styles are often designated by specific names, such as Baroque, Victorian, or the International style. These are to name a few. The third fundamental design element is form. Mass and shape define form. Mass refers to the volume defined by a structure relative to its surrounding and to its solidity and weight. Shape is the composition and complexity of the surface planes. The last fundamental design element is materials. Both exterior and interior of the building materials should be selected based upon their appropriateness for the building type, durability, impact on the environment, climate conditions, and the prevailing architectural design and characters of the installations. Aesthetic influences. Contemporary culture advocates diversity of styles, even in cases of historic preservation. It also encourages the development of new architectural languages. In response to this openness, designers agree that aesthetically successful architecture comes from an integrated approach. By correctly formulating a project's purpose, seeking inspiration in programmatic requirements, and engaging in team-wide design reviews, an architect most effectively arrives at a solution that is delightful as it is cost-effective, secure or safe, sustainable, accessible, and functional or operational. Here are some federal projects. Jose V. Toledo, U.S. Post Office and Courthouse, Old San Juan, Puerto Rico. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration Satellite Operations Facility, Switzerland, MD. Air Force Academy Cadet Chapel. Howard M. Metzenbaum, U.S. Courthouse, Cleveland, Ohio. Now on to design considerations. It is important to have basic understanding of the mechanism that can affect air and moisture transfer and how material selection, design, and construction can impact the proper drying of a building enclosure in any climate. In particular, architects, engineers, contractors, building scientists, owners, and others involved in the construction and maintenance of the building enclosure must understand the wetting and drying process, the safe storage capacity for moisture of the materials specified, and the manner in which those materials are likely to behave in a given climate. They must understand how poor design and/or construction with limited regards to the wetting, drying, storage process can have a potential devastating impact on the long-term durability and performance of the building enclosure. A An effective building enclosure should also include a continuous and defined air barrier that is rigid enough to survive a wind loading and air pressures across it, durable enough to remain intact throughout construction and installed in such a way that is continuous between building elements. And that is it for aesthetics. Thank you.
So the next topic is about moisture transfer. So controlling moisture flow in a building has significant impacts on occupant health and safety, comfort, building durability, and energy efficiency. Building science is concerned with two main forms of moisture flow, liquid and vapor. So liquid water moves as bulk water and capillary action, while water vapor moves through air leakage and diffusion. So bulk moisture movement or liquid flow has the potential to be extremely damaging to buildings. Typically thought of as rain or snow, bulk moisture movement also includes groundwater. So there are three conditions that are required to allow bulk moisture flow into a building. First is a source of water, second, a hole in the building envelope, and third is a driving force such as gravity, capillary action, wind, and many more.
So what is a capillary action? Capillary action refers to the ability of water to travel up against the pull of gravity through a porous material. One common example of this action is water wicking up through a paper towel. Although not commonly as serious as bulk water movement, capillary forces are both powerful and difficult to detect, since they often work in the dark of a crawl space, causing significant damage to a building without the occupant's knowledge. So rainwater striking the side of the house will run down the siding to the edge. Capillary forces can then draw the bead of water up and behind the siding, thus wetting the backside of the siding. Obviously, such forms of capillarity can be hard to observe until serious damage has already occurred. Capillary action can best be controlled by providing a capillary break, such as plastic, metal, damp-proofing compound, or another impermeable material, or by leaving air spaces that are too large for capillarity to occur. For example, installing a sealed seal between the masonry foundation and any wood structure is essential to protect the wood.
So here's an example. As you can see, the grate is sloped to drain water away from the foundation. Second, a damp proofing limits moisture migration from the soil into the concrete wall. Third, any water up against the foundation wall will drain down the free, draining backfill and out the perimeter drain at the footing. Fourth, a capillary break in between footing and foundation wall. And the fifth is a capillary break in between foundation wall and sill plate prevents moisture from migrating from the concrete into the wood structure.
So what is an air transported moisture? Air transported moisture is in the form of water vapor being transported by air, can get into or out of buildings. Both uncontrolled pressure sources such as wind or stack effect and controlled sources such as fans and air handlers can move significant amounts of moist air through a building's envelope. Leaky ductwork can cause moisture problems by not only increasing the amount of infiltration but by drawing air in from the humid crawl space or basement areas. As this humid air travels through a building, the moisture in it may condense on any surface whose temperature is below the dew point. So the amount of condensation that forms is dependent upon several factors. The first one is temperature of condensing surfaces. Second is the relative humidity and the speed of the air moving across the condensing surface. Colder surfaces like windows and poorly insulated walls condense moisture more readily. Slower moving airs allows more time for condensate to form. There are several ways to decrease the negative effects of air transported moisture. The best defense is to keep moist air out of the building through effective sealing against infiltration or exfiltration. Sealing the ductwork and pressure balancing the HVAC system. Proper use of exhaust fans in all bathrooms and kitchens helps to remove moisture-rich indoor air at its source. Preventing cold spots through adequate insulation. Heating and air movement removes potential sites for condensation.
Vapor diffusion is the movement of moisture from areas of high vapor pressure to areas of low vapor pressure. Even without leaks, small amounts of moisture in the form of water vapor can pass directly through a building's envelope by a process called diffusion. Vapor diffusion from a damp or wet basement or crawl space into the living space can significantly increase the moisture levels inside a home. So here is an illustration. As you can see, vapor comes from a higher dew point temperature to a low dew point temperature where it condenses. So there are two things that determine the amount of vapor diffusion that occurs in a building. First is the driving force that pushes it, known as the vapor pressure differential, and the permeability of the material through which the vapor is passing. Most materials, even sheet glass, are unable to completely stop vapor diffusion. Thus, calling something a vapor barrier is not quite correct, since it doesn't stop vapor completely. The current trend in building science is to refer to materials as vapor retarders, meaning that while they slow down the movement of water vapor, they do not completely halt the process. Materials that significantly slow down the vapor diffusion process are said to have low permeability or simply low perm. Typical building codes classify vapor retarders as Class 1, impermeable vapor retarders rated at 0.1 perms or less. Sheet polyethylene or bisquin or unperforated aluminum foil or FSK are Class 1 vapor retarders. Class 2 are semi-impermeable vapor retarders rated greater than 0.1 perms and less than or equal to 1.0 perms. The crop facing on bats qualify as Class 2 vapor retarders. Class 3 are semi-permeable vapor retarders rated greater than 1.0 perms and less than or equal to 10 perms. Plywood, OSB, latex, or enamel paints classify as Class 3 vapor retarders.
Hi everyone. Good day. For this part of the discussion, we will be discussing factors regarding durability in building envelope system and assemblies. To formally start our topic, let us first define what durability is. Durability is defined as the ability of the building or any of its components to perform the required functions in its service environment over a period of time, and without unforeseen cost for maintenance or repair. In other words, durability depicts a building envelope that is well planned and studied. In order for a building to be a well-planned one, we need to take into consideration the factors that determine a durable building. First one is the material and its environment. Second is installation, and lastly, the building's future maintenance and replacements. That being said, let us discuss material and its environment. The nature of the material used and the way it was assembled greatly affect the durability of the building. In the latter includes the material's structure, moisture, and fire resistance, loads, and corrosion resistance. The second one is installation, that deals with the process of installing the chosen material for its intended use. This does not only affects the performance of materials, but also causes problems in the future that results from poor installation. The third one is future maintenance and replacement that deals with the preservation of the building together with the materials used. The less the maintenance and replacement that the building requires, the more it symbolizes durability. Similarly, we must remember that addressing durability should not be a pursuit of extremes, but rather a cost-effectiveness strategy for both initial and longer term. Now, after we talked about the determinants of a durable building, let us now conclude the importance of it in the following factors. First is in general function of home and its component. Durability retains the investment value and continued function of every home as safe, healthy, and aesthetic environment. Next is in customer satisfaction. Materials in home that are installed without adequately considering durability can prematurely fail, which leads to customer satisfaction. Similarly, in builder and designer's reputation. Failure to meet reasonable expectations for durability increases liability. Lastly, the benefits in maintenance and repair. Durability decreases the operating and maintenance cost of home. For the final part of the discussion, I will be deliberating the web of durability. At the core of durability are three of the major systems in a house: envelope, structure, and mechanicals. Each of these affects the other. On the periphery are the forces that can also affect each of these core systems. That's it for this discussion. Thank you and have a good day.
Good day. Now, we will discuss about energy and material resources. Since that most common objective in the building envelope construction is to make it a sustainable building, thus becoming an energy efficient structure, let us focus on the designs which consider energy and material resources, that will be tackled later. Designing of buildings and its envelope has a major focus on making buildings sustainable by reducing energy consumption without compromising on users' comfort. Energy-efficient building design involves constructing or upgrading buildings that are able to get the most work out of the energy that is supplied to them by taking steps to reduce energy loss, such as decreasing the loss of heat through the building envelope. Energy-efficient homes, whether they are renovated to be more efficient or are built with energy efficiency in mind, pose a significant number of benefits. These homes are less expensive to operate, more comfortable to live in, and more environmental friendly. The amount of energy lost through the envelope is influenced by both design and materials. Therefore, energy-efficient building envelope design measures can be generally separated into two groups. First, the architectural design measure. Second is the material design measure. Under the first group, design considerations affect the placement of windows and doors, the size and location of which can be optimized to reduce energy usage. On the other hand, under second group, decisions regarding the appropriate material also play a vital role in determining the energy performance. Now, let's study the architectural design measure first. We have, optimize building form to minimize heat gains through surface. Building form refers to the shape or configuration of a building. Size and orientation of the exterior envelope are the ones that exposed directly in an outdoor environment. We also have, orient building towards north-south exposures to take advantage of north-south daylighting. Under this, we have two light exposures, namely, southern lighting and northern lighting. Southern light provides warm, ambient light throughout the day and generally feels sunny and comfortable. It is usually practical to maximize daylighting by orienting buildings so that spaces that require ample light for activities and comfort, and where occupants spend a majority of time, get the most southern exposure. While northern light is indirect, meaning that it is always in shadow and can cause spaces to feel dark and cold. North-facing windows receive the least amount of light of any orientation, but the benefit is that northern light it is diffuse and does not typically need to be controlled for glare. Next we have, turn long facade toward the prevailing breezes to enhance natural ventilation. Facade is defined as the outside or all of the external faces of a building. Also, employ solar shading devices to block direct solar radiation. The use of sun control and shading devices is an important aspect of many energy-efficient building design strategies. You may also use innovative wall type, for example, is a double skin wall. Construction of an energy-efficient wall must control intrusion of rain, groundwater, and vapor. Proper design of window area and size or window to wall ratio may also be considered. Window-wall ratio or WWR is one of the key energy-saving design parameters affecting the energy consumption of nearly zero-energy building or the NZEB in severe cold regions. Window-wall ratio is the specific value of the area of the window and that of the room facade. Unit area of room facade indicates the area enclosed by the room height and the standard width of the bay. Install wing walls to improve natural ventilation may also be considered. The wing walls are built as extensions of the building foundation on the downhill side of the structure. They hold back the soil to create open lawn area outside a walkout basement. Install light shelves to penetrate daylight deep into the building. The term light shelves usually refers to horizontal surfaces mounted inside a building. These interior light shelves divide windows between the viewable portion and the part that lets in additional natural light, bouncing it upward and reflecting it off the ceiling to let daylight penetrate deeper into the floor plate. Since we're done with the architectural design measure, let's now proceed to material design measure. First is, insulate the exterior wall and roof to avoid humid air infiltration. This is your primary defense against heat loss through the house envelope. Next, use high-performance concrete for its thermal mass. High-performance concrete may be defined as concrete with strength and durability significantly beyond those obtained by normal means. We also have, use reflective exterior wall/roof finishes to reduce solar heat gain. Reflective materials applied to opaque building components are becoming increasingly important because of their benefits in terms of thermal comfort and energy savings. Because of their optical properties, reflective materials stay cooler than standard materials under the same conditions, therefore, they are also known as cool materials. Next we have, use innovative construction materials, for example is fiber-reinforced polymer. Other examples include, structural insulated panels, another is, recycled wood or plastic composite lumber. Also we have low-E windows, next is earth, moving on, we have incorporate windows with low-E or reflective coating. Low-E stands for low emissivity. In the glass and window industry, this term refers to glass that has been treated with a coating during the manufacturing process. Next is incorporate windows with tinted or multiple layers of glazing. There are three fundamental approaches to improving the energy performance of glazing products, or two or more of these approaches may be combined. The first approach is to alter the glazing material itself by changing its chemical composition or physical characteristics. An example of this is tinted glazing. The second approach is to apply a coating to the glazing material surface. Reflective coatings and films were developed to reduce heat gain and glare, and more recently, low emittance coatings have been developed to improve both heating and cooling season performance. The third approach is to assemble various layers of glazing and control the properties of the spaces between the layers. Lastly, incorporate windows with thermally improved frame. Thermally improved windows may include a combination of features resulting in a lower U factor, such as high-performance frame design and low conductance spacers in combination with high-performance glazing. Now we're done with material design measures.